author of Fallow and Her Keepers, and today I'm here in Hodges, South Carolina with Kay, the president and founder of Frog Song Farm Sanctuary. And today she's going to tell us a little bit about how Frog Song got here, what animals we have here, and just what goes on day to day. So Kay, tell me just a little bit about yourself.
Okay. Well, my name is Kay Williams. My husband, who's not here today, is Richard D'Antoni. And we started Frog Song Farm Sanctuary in Cairo, Georgia in 2016. My background is that I was an RN and then I was an attorney. So I have no background in animal rescue or veterinary medicine. A lifelong love of animals, and I think it finally hit me that I always read all of the rescue books, watched all the rescue movies, always thought, I'd love to do that. And then it finally hit me that I was not getting any younger and that I wasn't going to be doing it when I was 85 years old, in all likelihood. Maybe I'll oversee it, but I'm not going to be wrangling a horse when I'm 85, probably. So we just did it we just jumped into it. And fortunately, you don't start with a million animals. So we gradually added them in. We loved Cairo. We loved our neighbors. We loved our vets. It was really hard to leave, but we had 42 acres. Not all of it was pasture, and we just ran out of room and with no place to expand. So we looked for probably a year and a half to find enough acreage that would work for us, for our animals, and found Hodges in this early spring, early in the year of 2020, and started moving. So now we're here. We have seven senior llamas. We have 16 goats. We have 10 zebu cows, and that's a miniature breed, and then six full size. And then 20 equines, donkeys and horses, and miniature horses, and all kinds of combinations. Close to 100 ducks, a few barn cats, 5 chickens. I think that's everybody. Probably leaving somebody out when all of them. But
and then we have these two off camera playing, plus yes. Another little one that I got to meet earlier. We'll talk about her later. What's a typical day here look like to you from start to finish?
Well, the truth is we don't have typical days because every single day is different. I mean, how you imagine your day to be is that you start with morning rounds, and those take the longest because a lot of animals only get fed once a day. That would be in the morning. A bunch of our animals are on medication because we have a lot of animals that are not special needs or seniors, but that is really our mission. And so we have a lot of animals that need medication or supplements or special diets. I just start in the barn and we start feeding and medicating and making the rounds and hoping that we don't find something that will make our planned day go awry. And that's sometimes that happens and sometimes that doesn't. Then we'll spend the rest of the day usually has a project. Maybe it's the farrier, maybe it's the vet, maybe it's a visitor, or maybe it's just the grocery store and the dentist.
Yeah.
And then we have evening rounds. And those are generally faster because there's generally less animals to feed. Most of the medication is given in the morning, so that's our evening.
Okay. And you do this all yourself. You don't have help right now, do you?
No. To be fair, I have two volunteers that are semi-regular. Kathy is very regular, and she comes about 3 days a week, and she's wonderful. And Carolyn just doesn't live in the area, but both of them are really, they know the animals, they're very good with the animals, and they are very helpful. But day in and day out, it's mostly me and Richard. And we sort of have a division of labor in that I typically handle the animals and the vets and that sort of thing. Richard is super handy, and so he builds a lot of the stuff. He does the fence repair, he runs the tractor, And he is the one typically when we have to drag a trailer to the vet, he'll be the one that does that. But so yeah, that's how we divide things up.
So my next question, of course, would be, are you in need of volunteers, and what are you looking for in a volunteer?
Yes, we are just really coming out of the pandemic and starting to look into having a regular volunteer program. And that's something that certainly I have talked about with Carolyn and Kathy quite a bit. So the plan, the ideal situation would be to have people who can commit to coming pretty regularly. Our animals' needs change from week to week. So somebody who just wants to come a couple of hours once a month is really more of a visitor than a volunteer, which is great. We love visitors too, but so what we're looking for is somebody who can come frequently enough to really get to know our animals and have the animals know them so that things run smoothly.
Okay. And so right now you're not open to the public, but you're hoping to be in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. We get inquiries all the time about people wanting to come visit, and we want them to come visit and get to know the animals. It is just difficult to work that into our schedule, and our first priority is always the animals, because it is a sanctuary. We're not a petting zoo, we're not, you know, an animal safari, we are their sanctuary. So I think the regular visitors are going to will start as soon as we have a comfortable volunteer program that can help us get that done.
Okay. We
have six dogs. We had five that were our personal dogs before we started the sanctuary, and it didn't seem right to throw them in the sanctuary and let the sanctuary pay their expenses. So they are our personal dogs, but Rosie, the little one you just mentioned, she's a sanctuary dog. She's the only official sanctuary dog, which really you can't tell the difference because they all live in the house with us and sleep in the bed with us. But the sanctuary does pay her vet bills, and that's the only difference.
So tell me about Rosie while we're here. How did she come to be a member?
Rosie, we were driving down the road in when we were down in southern Georgia. It was July. It was about 100 million degrees. The pavement was blazingly hot, and she was dragging herself down the road with her back legs not working at all. She was trying to catch a couple of dogs that were up ahead of her. That she couldn't catch up to, and we stopped and asked around, and nobody knew who she belonged to, nobody had seen her. So we scooped her up, took her to our vet, and she was not microchipped, we couldn't find a home for her. So we treated her with steroids and physical therapy, and she can walk. Mm-hmm. We think she is a miniature wire-haired dachshund or some combination of something. And she runs all over the farm, although her back end is a little bit independent of the rest of her. She dances and shimmies, but she gets around.
She has covered more ground today than I think I have in my entire life. Something exciting that is now happening here is this lovely place. You want to tell us about it?
Yes! We have a guest house here that we have converted to an Airbnb, and we are not yet in the Airbnb program because we're still putting the finishing touches on everything, but we will be shortly. Mm-hmm. So we have this house that sits here in the middle of the farm, three bedrooms with queen-size beds. I'm sorry, one king, two queens, a bath and a half, a full kitchen, washer and dryer, and all of the proceeds will go to help support the animals here.
On average, how much does it take to run the farm, to care for all the animals, to do the vet visits, the medicine, you know, everything?
You know, that's a good question, and it varies, of course, depending on, like, particularly the vet bill for any given month, because we have some months that are, you know, $20,000, and we have other months that are closer to 8 to 10, probably. Winter's more expensive because we have hay and more feed for the animals than when they can have the grass. But I would probably probably say on average about 10,000. One of the reasons it's hard for me to answer that directly is because we keep adding animals and we have yet to have a year where we say, okay, well, everything has been stable this year, so this is what it costs per month.
Yep. Animal rescue.
Yeah, and of course we moved in 2020, so it's hard. You would think I could just give you a flat out number, but it's really hard for me to come up with a number.
So how can people find you? Are you on social media?
We are. We have a Facebook page. We have an Instagram feed. And I have a website, which is, I will admit, is sorely neglected just because of time constraints. But I'm working on getting that more up to speed. But our website has a page where I have each of the animals with a small bio, which is super helpful for people who are trying to put names to faces when I talk about the different animals. And then they can sponsor those animals through our website.
Okay. Tell me, how did you get the name Frog Song?
Well, when we were in Cairo, we had a lot of marsh behind us, and it was just filled with frogs to the point where if you were out in the evening especially, you could hardly carry on a conversation. They were so noisy. Now, I loved them. So I always said they were singing to us. So that's where the name came from.
Awesome.